The next item of business is topical questions. In order to get in as many members as possible, short and succinct questions and responses would be appreciated. At question number one, I call Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to address the reported growing concerns over the shortfall of psychiatrists employed by the NHS to deliver psychiatric care.
Minister Marie Todd.
We are actively encouraging medical students to consider a long-term psychiatry career. We've created 42 additional posts in core psychiatry since 2014, and with one exception, 100% of entry-level posts have been filled for the fourth year. The Psychiatry Recruitment and Retention Working Group will be reporting back to ministers in spring 25. The Royal College of Psychiatrists in Scotland are critical partners in this work, and the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care is meeting with college representatives on Thursday. Ensuring the provision of high quality and safe patient care remains our utmost priority.
Edward Mountain.
Well, that sounds like a lot of things in the future, but I thank the Minister for the answer. And I thank The Guardian and the BBC, who have done some investigation into this, and that health boards are paying up to £837 an hour for locum psychiatrists. And last year, payments exceeded £35 million. Not only that, but there are serious concerns that some locums are being used for remote consultations from places outside the UK, such as India, meaning they're not even members of the Royal College of Psychiatrists. Does the Minister accept these concerns and that mental health services in Scotland are indeed at breaking point?
Minister.
So I certainly do accept these concerns. I'm aware of the incident that Edward Mountain raises with me of a psychiatrist who was working outside of the UK. I am assured that the arrangement only happened when there were no consultant psychiatrists available to work in that particular health board, and the practice has been stopped. So it's not a widely common practice. I'm absolutely aware of the challenges which exist across the workforce and which can be particularly marked in more remote and rural areas. It's very helpful to see the latest statistics which show an increase in full-time posts in the last year, and it's indeed an increase since 2014. I have absolutely no doubt that there are concerns. There are, as I mentioned in response to a question last week, there are concerns in particular areas of the country, so particularly remote and rural areas find it difficult to recruit, and there are concerns in particular specialties, and we're working closely with the Royal College and others to try to improve that situation.
Edward Mountain.
Well, there's a surprise. Emergency locums used because there's an emergency. When the Minister and I were both elected as regional Highland and Island MSPs, we both knew the problems facing patients in the Highlands. We had new Craigs reducing bed numbers, a shortage of psychiatrists, and constituents having to travel vast distances to have or having online consultations via near me with different psychiatrists. It's clear, Minister, you have no idea of the extent of the problem and have had no idea of it before it was flagged up to you as a result of this investigation. Surely, if you did, the Scottish Government would have done some workforce planning years ago, and you haven't. Do you think,
through
Minister,
the chair, please, always, Mr. Mountain.
Yes, thank you.
Do continue, Mr. Mountain.
Sorry, I'm hearing a lot of barracking from my right. It's difficult to answer the question.
I'd be grateful if members could resist any temptation to contribute. Mr. Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I don't believe the Minister had any idea of the problems until they were flagged up as a result of this investigation. Otherwise, they would have done proper workforce planning to ensure that this didn't happen. Trying to solve the problem now is like bolting the door after the horse has bolted. Minister, do you think you really are in charge of what's going on?
Again, Mr. Mountain, I would ask that you speak always through the chair. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The member is absolutely aware that before I came into politics, I worked for 20 years as a mental health pharmacist in NHS Highland, and this issue is very close to my heart and has been throughout my working life. Not only that, it's important to my constituents, and many of the issues that he raises in the Chamber today have been raised with me, and I, in turn, have raised them with NHS Highland. I'm well aware of the challenges which exist right across the workforce. It's really helpful to see that the latest statistics for NHS Highland mental health nursing staff have increased by 3.6% in the latest 12 months to 30th September 24, whilst the numbers of psychiatry staff increased to 10.5% in that period. So despite that huge improvement in view of the ongoing challenges that NHS Highland has, my officials continue to offer enhanced monitoring and support to NHS Highland's mental health services. I'd like to address what we're doing nationally to tackle these issues. The Mental Health and Wellbeing Workforce Action Plan, committed to the ongoing work of Psychiatry Recruitment and Retention Working Group, which is considering how we can better support the recruitment and retention of psychiatrists. That Psychiatry Working Group, as I said in answer to your first question, are actively exploring possible solutions to address the issues, such as the use of locums. They're going to meet in December 24 and will report back to me in spring next year, and I look forward to seeing that report and taking forward their recommendations.
Emma Harper.
It is welcome to hear what the Minister has just outlined about what is happening right now, but can the Minister set out what the change in psychiatry and mental health workforce has been over the last decade, and what impact pension rules set by the UK Government have on retention of psychiatrists?
Minister.
So the Member asks a really good question, because whilst there are record numbers of staff providing mental health support to a larger number of people than ever before, it doesn't feel like that on the ground, and we absolutely acknowledge that. That is why we have continued to invest heavily in our mental health workforce, and that's the broad multidisciplinary health workforce. I've referenced already the increase in mental health nursing and in psychiatrists in Highland in 24-25, supporting it in order to support multidisciplinary teams. The Scottish Government provided NHS boards with approximately 2.7 million for mental health pharmacists and technicians, providing NHS Scotland with around 30 million to continue education for training and workforce expansion. The Member is now barracking me from a sedentary position. I'm finding it profoundly unhelpful as I try to get on the record the work that we are doing in response to the question he has asked. We've exceeded our commitment to provide funding for 320 additional staff in CAMHS by 2026, and that has funded over 800 additional mental health workers. We have also funded over 800 additional mental health workers in A&E departments, GP practices, police custody suites and in prisons. The issue of pension taxation is reserved. We have raised it with the UK Government, recognising that we have limited ability to influence that space. We've taken the action that we can by devolving powers to NHS boards to use local flexibilities within NHS pension arrangements and to use to offer pension recycling.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Yet Scotland's mental health has worsened by all measures in the most recent Scottish Mental Health Survey. The CAMHS waiting time target has never been met, and 28,000 Scots in total are waiting on mental health support. We've seen the government response being an extortionate sticking plaster of spending over £130 million on locum psychiatrists over the last 5 years, and indeed, as we've heard, health boards paying up to £837 an hour to plug the gaps. Is the Minister's idea of a robust NHS workforce strategy anything resembling that sort of figure? And does she consider this expenditure to be an appropriate and good value use of taxpayers' money?
Minister.
So the NHS Scotland staffing pay bills over £10 billion a year, with spending on locum psychiatrists is a tiny fraction of that. And spend on locum psychiatrists, as the Member is aware, is managed locally by health boards. Health boards should always be seeking to secure the best value when they enter into arrangements regarding the use of locums. And at a national level, as I mentioned in response to the question last week, we've established a medical locum task and finish group in order to review and improve the processes and practices adopted when engaging locum at a local level. In reference to the first part of the Member's question in terms of the rise of demand, there is undoubtedly a rise in demand that we've seen in some parts of the country. For example, a 1,500% increase in requests for neurodevelopmental assessment. These are pressures which could not have been predicted, so that relates to the reduction in stigma associated with these causes, which is a really good thing, but it undoubtedly adds to the challenge in managing the current situation.
Thank you. Question number two, Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the reported view of the Royal College of Emergency Medicine that its winter planning is not doing enough to support A&E departments as they approach their busiest time of year.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We know that there are challenges to come for our health and social care system this winter, and particularly our accident emergency departments. Our health and social care winter preparedness plan sets out how we will ensure that people in Scotland receive safe and timely access to health and social care services and support over the winter. We have a number of specific actions that will help to reduce pressure on our busy accident emergencies, such as improving discharge planning, enhancing our hospital at home services, and treating more people in the community where it is clinically appropriate to do so. Additionally, we have recruited a record number of NHS 24 call handlers who will be available this winter to direct people to the most appropriate care, helping to reduce unnecessary accident emergency attendances.
Carol Mockin.
Thank you for that answer. Public Health Scotland recently revealed that levels of delayed discharge from hospitals reached a record high in August, one of our warmest months. The Royal College of Physicians have said this should be a cause for huge alarm. Does the Cabinet Secretary think hospital staff will gain any confidence from a government saying the same thing they say year after year?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I accept the fact that delayed discharge is too high and there's too wide a variation in performance in our delayed discharge performance of local systems. That's why I've been meeting with COSLA and local chief officers on a weekly basis to monitor progress. And I believe that if it hadn't been for that intervention, that support and that whole system approach over the summer, we would have seen an even worse picture in terms of delayed discharge. I'm hoping that the work that has been put in by local systems, in particular those that have had the most challenging position to address, the work that is being done in those local systems at pace, it will bear fruit and we'll see a reduction coming forward, but we need to reduce much faster so that we can give confidence to those staff that are working in our acute sector to ensure that they feel prepared for winter.
Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. One in five care homes have closed since 2014, according to the Care Home Census. That's 18% less than a decade ago, whilst demand is going rapidly upwards. Many more are likely to close over the coming years, and this is the root cause of hospital overcrowding. People have nowhere to go. Cabinet Secretary, is it not the case that the government has lost control of social care?
Always through the chair, please. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. No, that's not the case. We are continuing to work with local government, looking at areas such as the National Care Home Contract, looking at areas such as improving the advice and guidance that's available for treating and supporting people without adults without capacity, to make sure that we are supporting the position in these local areas. There have been challenges with regards to care home closures and the decisions that have been taken at local level in that regard, but I am seeing more cause for optimism in some of the more challenging areas where they're looking at more innovative ways of bringing some of those care homes back into use, and I think that's going to be important. But we also have to recognise that residential care is not the right place for everybody, and actually we need to be supporting more people at home. So hospital at home is an important investment that we're making. It's now the eighth largest hospital for geriatric services in Scotland, and we'll continue to support the work of expanding that, both as a means to support people to stay at home for longer, but to avoid hospital in the first place.
Claire Hawhey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I refer members to my register of interests? I hold a bank nurse contract with Greater Glasgow and Clyde NHS. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise me what additional support the Scottish Government is providing to health boards to implement its winter planning?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This year there is a record number of NHS 24 call handlers available for this winter to direct people to the most appropriate care. We've also strengthened arrangements to alternative services such as flow navigation centres or same-day emergency care, supporting people to receive the right care in the right place and helping to reduce unnecessary A&E attendances. And over the months ahead, we'll continue to work with boards to enhance patient flow at our acute sites, improve discharge planning planning and hospital-at-home services and reduced conveyance of people from care homes where it is clinically appropriate. And we've baselined the funding available for health boards to support all year-round surge planning rather than just being a focus at winter, as we recognise that this is a pressure potentially that could be faced at any point in the year.
Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Royal College of Emergency Medicine has said, and I quote, "We're seeing lots of discussion, but we haven't seen any useful measures so far that will make any better for people working in A&Es this winter." And that sums up the situation perfectly. Time and time again, Cabinet Secretary, you've been in post for 8 months, you wheeled out to provide
through the chair, please,
screens, but the Cabinet Secretary hasn't delivered any meaningful action. Why has the Cabinet Secretary failed to improve A&E times?
Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So, first of all, I fully respect the views of the Royal College. I went to Forth Valley Hospital with the Royal College of Emergency Medicine to see the work that's been done there to improve the flow through accident emergency. I recognise the pressure that there is within our accident emergency services, partly due to the delayed discharge picture and the need for us to get beds further available within hospitals, but also social care packages in place for people to be able to return home and to not to leave hospital without delay. That is what we're supporting local systems to try to achieve, both getting the processes right and exemplifying best practice, but also supporting those that have got further to travel to ensure that they're able to meet with our expectations of a much better service for the people we're here to serve.
And Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary has mentioned hospital at home a couple of times in his answers. Can the Cabinet Secretary say any more about the steps the Scottish Government is taking to further develop the programme, which we know plays an important role in reducing pressure on hospitals and ambulance services?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank Joe Fitzpatrick for raising a really important issue here. To continue to develop the hospital at home service, the Scottish Government has made £3.6 million of funding available for 2024-25, taking the overall funding of hospital at home for older people to over £15 million since 2020. Its continued investment demonstrates that the Scottish Government is committed to hospital at home and sees it as a national priority. By providing care in this way, we're enabling more people to receive treatment in the comfort of their own home rather than on an acute ward, relieving the pressure that there is on the frontline services in traditional hospital settings, but crucially for those patients, getting better outcomes for them, meaning that they are re-enabled at home, they are more likely to stay at home for longer and require a smaller social care package as a result. It's a win-win and why we're continuing to invest in it.